Okay, we've got two mature adults hanging out together in a fairly defined reef. Like, there's not much else around. That horseshoe was carved out by a fish. And we've got a sexually mature male and a sexually mature female.
Side by side.
That's something that I don't know many people who've seen before.
Yeah.
So this looked like a breeding scar.
It sure does.
Except it's a large male.
Maybe it could have been another male competing.
Yeah, it could well be competitive behavior. So it's plausible that this male was mating and another male came up, grabbed its dorsal fin, gave it a rip in order to get rid of it. But I mean, this shows evidence to me of some type of breeding at least happening in this area or at least recently to this animal.
Yeah, I mean, it looks very recent.
I think the females are definitely coming back. In fact, I believe that two of the females that we saw were pregnant. So they're coming back to this area because they come back to the area where they were born to have their pups.
Actually seeing mature males and females hanging out together in a fairly predictable spot, that's a game changer. They've got to be doing something there. They're socializing, they're mating. This is an extremely rare find.
Finding areas where sawfish aggregate and mate is a good step towards understanding the species. But the vital next step is identifying places where they give birth and protecting them. On the west coast of Florida, an amateur photographer has captured what might be a once-in-a-lifetime sight. A mating attempt by mature sawfish near a known sawfish nursery. This could be the first time this behavior has ever been caught on camera. Researchers believe a nursery near the Charlotte Harbor estuary may be genetically connected to adults on the Atlantic coast and Florida Keys. For Greg to get a more complete picture of the life cycle in South Florida, he has to start where they're born. So Luke and Greg head out into the Peace River to find and tag juvenile sawfish.
We're gonna go ahead directly across the river, a place called Pepper Tree Point first. The place we've caught them pretty consistently over the last few years. We've had some reports recently there, so we're hoping they'll be around today.
Sawfish like sandy bottoms, so they head near the shore.
Right now we're motoring in about 2 to 3 feet of water. We're really shallow and it's just kind of an exercise of keeping your eyes on the water and looking for the outline of the sawfish as it sits on the bottom.
These dense mangroves provide shelter for young sawfish.
There's a lot of animals that use the mangrove systems as a critical part of their life cycle. Most of them use it as a nursery, so the adults will come in and deliver their young, they'll leave the young behind, and that's a nice place for them to be safe, to grow up a little bit before they head out into the open ocean.
But this nursery habitat is threatened as well, which hurts any potential recovery of the sawfish.
The nursery at Port Charlotte is a fairly typical mangrove area until you kind of look the other way and realize that, oh, that's a condo, that's a hotel, that's a marina. You know, there's all these developments that are backed up to a fairly natural nursery, a very necessary nursery.
Mangroves thrive where salt and freshwater mix, and young sawfish need healthy mangroves.
Being up in the shallows and in the mangrove roots gives them a bit of protection, especially as juveniles, and also there's tons of food for them to eat, lots of little fish.
The research boats set out gill nets. The fine mesh will capture anything traveling through the water column. Sawfish can circulate water over their gills, so if they get caught in the net, they won't be suffocated.
By grabbing the lead line and stretching it out so the gill net is visible all the way to the float, we can make sure that there is nothing caught in there and that we're not missing anything as we walk the line.
The team works for hours with no sign of sawfish.
We've got the gill net out here and we're walking the line looking for sawfish, but in walking the line, we came across this. This is the fin of probably a juvenile bull shark. It's been finned, probably caught by a local. It really impresses the need.
Sawfish!
Sawfish! We got a sawfish. Let's go.
See that faint line right there? It's about 3 feet long. It's right there in the net.
The small sea sawfish became critically endangered due in large part to bycatch. They get caught in almost any kind of a fishing net.
But Greg uses the fishing net as a tool to catch, tag, and save these fish.
Right now it's wrapped up by the rostrum. Greg's team here are gonna carefully free it, put it in the tub, ready for workup.
You know, we just wanna make sure we get it out of the net and get it untangled as soon as we can.
Yeah! Hey, buddy. Been looking everywhere for you. Now this is what we've been looking so hard for. This is a juvenile small tooth sawfish. Now it looks kind of like a shark, but it's actually a ray.
Sawfish are relatives of sharks, but have evolved their own distinct characteristics.
One of the ways you can tell is that the pectoral fins here are connected to the head. That's a ray-like feature. Also the spiracles on the top of the head pumping away tells us it's a ray. Now you can see this very impressive rostrum here with the teeth staggered pattern. And then of course, two dorsal fins, which makes it kind of look like a shark, and a single lobed caudal fin. On the ventral surface, we can really tell it's a ray. Up forward, you have the nostrils and the mouth. You can see these very, very small teeth are kind of more built for crushing things.
Sawfish are an example of form following function. Their toothed rostrum is an incredible success story of evolution. When they swim, the saw barely disturbs the surrounding water, making sawfish the ultimate stealth hunter. Sawfish use their ampullae of Lorenzini to detect the electrical fields given off by their prey. The ampullae are located on both sides of their rostrum, so they can attack while swimming or lie in wait burrowed in the sand. As they swipe their blade, it is undetectable to potential prey until it's too late. The razor-sharp rostral teeth have already sliced, impaled, or pinned down their next meal.